met here in 2018. Who here has been to a Faith on Fire before? Pretty good. And who here is the first time? First time. Oh, excellent. Fantastic. So it is an event that's happened the last couple of years. We have one a year. And I think, gosh, this is the biggest crowd, I think, as well. I can think about the biggest crowd. We will get started with a prayer. My name is Father Kevin Fazio, the pastor here at St. Al's. And welcome everybody, Catholic, non-Catholic, member outside St. Al's or elsewhere to Wexford and certainly to our area. I hope you got to blow the horns on the fire trucks outside.
Maybe get used with the organization.
Thanks, guys, we'll get to some of that a little bit later. So let's begin with, as we do all things as we should, with a prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Recognize that we are always in your presence, Lord. We start our prayer with an attitude of gratitude and thanksgiving for the gift of life and the gift of love. As we read from John's Gospel, chapter 15. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you keep my commandments. But longer do I call you slaves, for the slave does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. Father, we ask your blessings upon us this evening as we thank you for bringing us together, that through the next hour and a half or so, we may be moved ever more in love with the heart of your Son, who laid down his life for us as the example supreme to follow him and lay down our lives, however you ask us to, for those you put in our lives. Through Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
We're going to kick off with a tune here, and the reason why we chose this tune was just because I like it. but there's some method behind the madness. So we have a guest speaker from New York City, and this song was written by a New Yorker, I think in 1979. And if you know, written and performed, so if you know the lyrics, please help me. April Shanahan doesn't need help. We got April on vocals, we got Amy Chalmers, we got Darren Parasovich, we got Amy Donovan with us this evening as well. April doesn't need help, I do. So sing along if you know the words.
Out in bed, killing time, killing out.
led is born out of our CIA program, the rate of Christian initiation of adulthood. It's all those who are adults, young adults, who are either not Catholic or not fully initiated into the Catholic faith and desire to do so. Well, I always ask, who here is a convert? If you want to stand up, as a convert, stand up. Give me a hand, get on. Here in, just started RCIA this year, just a few weeks ago. Anybody here from our RCIA program right now that started just a few weeks ago? Anybody here stand on up? I don't know if anyone was able to make it or not tonight. We do have a few people that were that started, I think we have three or four that started. So, and we have a core team that helps out as well. So our core team members, I see a few. Jen over there, she helps out. She does the food, she does RCIA. Who else? I thought I saw Keith here. Paul is here. Keith's here. Oh, we got, all right, there we go. So, okay, good. Good to have you guys. Thank you for coming out as well. As part of the program, that we have what we call a witness speaker. And our witness speaker was received into the faith last Easter. At the Easter Vigil, and he's here to share with us a little bit about his story. So let's welcome Glenn and Tom.
Father Kevin and Lewis for inviting me to speak this evening about RCIA. And I'd also like to thank Reverend Thomas Colucci for being here tonight to share his experiences with us. I'm really looking forward to learning from him. Father Kevin and Lewis asked me to share my experiences in the RCIA program with you all. For those of you who may not know, RCIA stands for the Rite of Christian Initiation of Adults. But by now, some of you are probably wondering who I am and how did I get here, standing in front of you. I'll start by introducing myself. My name is Glenn Natale. My family and I moved from Boston to Wexford last year when I relocated for a new job opportunity. My wife Heather and I have two elementary school age children, Grayson and Rachel, who are hopefully behaving themselves in the child washroom right now. They better be. Heather's in there with them. My joining the parish and my reception into the Catholic faith really revolves around them. My wife is a cradle Catholic, and up until last April, I was a very enthusiastic priester. She and I decided to enroll the children in CCD at St. Alphonsus to learn more about the Catholic faith. At that time, I thought to myself, why are we really enrolling our kids in this program? What values are we trying to instill in them? How will this make them better and enhance their lives? In my thoughts and discussions with others, I realized that I was actually searching for answers to those questions for me. That my kids weren't the only ones who needed to be grounded in caring, compassion, charity, and faith. I also wanted and needed that for myself. While I was baptized in the Catholic Church, I did not grow up with any specific denomination. My experiences with faith-based teachings came from my grandparents when we occasionally attended Mass together, and my nuclear family was not religious and it wasn't part of how I was raised. Even so, I always found myself interested in spirituality and world religions. I took classes in college and I dabbled in attending services of various denominations. Most of my friends are Catholic, and I would often engage them in conversations about religious teachings and how they were shaped by them. I would leave those conversations feeling like something was missing in my life. How nice it must have been to have been raised with a fundamental belief system in God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit. So suddenly I found myself in the position where my kids were making a commitment to the church, and I found that this would also be the right thing for me. Last September I started RCIA, classes right here at the Parish Center, and I began my spiritual journey. At first, I felt a little strange and sometimes skeptical of the things I was learning from the curriculum. This hadn't been a part of my life for the last 40 plus. However, each week I learned a little bit more, and I found my heart opening more and more to the teachings of Jesus. I also found camaraderie and communion with my fellow candidates, Rick, Ben, Melissa, and Mark. Some of you are here tonight. Lewis and the volunteers, I like to think of them as our spiritual coaches, were incredibly generous with their time, knowledge, and video clips. There were lots of video clips. They each played a truly inside joke, Jenna. They each played a truly significant role in our journey. So thank you, Keith, Tim, Jenna, Maureen, and Paula. Through RCIA, I was able to actualize the teachings of Jesus by volunteering at the Jubilee Soup Kitchen in Pittsburgh, participating in the rite of election at St. Paul's Cathedral, and meeting Bishop Zubik, resulting in my final confirmation into the church at the Easter Vigil Mass this year. The Easter Vigil was truly an awe-inspiring moment for me, and I never felt closer to God than being in our church, lit only by candlelight, surrounded by the fellowship of the parish. This experience was one of my proudest and most emotional moments of my life, and it signified the journey that all of us as candidates went through together to experience God's grace. Going through this amazing process and finally being able to participate in the act of communion continues to provide me with the care, compassion, charity, and faith that I was missing for so much of my life. I found through the love of my family and the community of St. Alphonsus the spiritual center I had been looking for. It was also a blessing to experience my first communion at the same time my son was making his first communion. Each night we would practice our prayers together before bed, and every night he corrected Dad until he got it just right. Those precious moments were and are such special experiences for me. It's like Jesus visits us each night, and I get to share him with my kids in all of these moments. I'm so happy I got to go through this journey with you, Father Kevin. I really appreciate the guidance, friendship, and support that you offered me through my passage into the Catholic faith. You will be missed, and don't be surprised if when you scan the audience before the homily to see who showed up, we know you do that, to see us sitting out there smiling back at you. Thanks again to Lewis, my fellow RCI graduates, and the dedicated volunteers who made this journey and my confirmation process so meaningful for all of us. Thanks to all of you for listening. Have a great night. Thank you.
The next tune we're going to play is a tune
that fits in many ways absolutely perfectly. It was written, I'm pretty sure, on September 12th, 2001. It was written and performed by a man named Scott Lazy. He's the lead singer of a group called the Clarks. And the Clarks are pretty well known in this area, and they probably made it, we'll say, regionally big. They made it on a Letterman show years ago, right? So they made it regionally big. And Lazy wrote this tune specifically about what happened the day before, September 11th. It's called Hey You. What also is interesting about Lazy, Scott Lazy, is a brother priest of mine in our diocese, his first assignment was in the South Hills at St. Benedict the Abbot in Peters Township. He was a young guy in his mid-20s when he was ordained. No, he was a little bit older. He was in his 30s when he was ordained. And he said for a few weeks straight, he would notice this guy in church on Sundays. And he was a big Clarks fan. He's like, looks like Scott Lazy. Is that Lazy? Finally got up enough courage to go up and introduce stuff to him. You're Scott Lazy? He said, yeah, I'm Scott Lazy. And he got to know Lazy and his family a little bit and discovered through their friendship that Scott Lazy and his wife are married civilly but not in the church. And through their friendship, over the course of a few months, this priest got Scott Lazy's marriage validated in the Catholic Church. So you got a rocker that actually goes to Mass on Sunday. That doesn't happen too often. We go all through the former Catholics. There are race Catholics, Springsteen, Madonna, Lady Gaga, Ivana. Scott Lazy, practicing Catholic, married in the church, and he wrote the song.
Father Kevin, if you don't mind, just a personal commentary on this song. When Father Kevin asked us to select this song, I had never heard of the group. I heard of the Clarks. I don't know the Clarks, but this particular song, did not know of it. And I'll be sensitive how I phrase this. I know we have a lot of young kids here, but you know, this song is essentially about some people that had to make some very difficult decisions when they were trapped in the towers and so forth, particularly above where the planes hit. So I'll leave it at that. And normally, I know it's hard to hear the lyrics sometimes, but if you listen closely, you'll hear it. I find it very moving.
If you're gonna drown, hey you, hang on. If you feel like giving up, hey you, hang on. Thank you.
New York. So let's welcome, and we'll have this tell us about his story, and then we'll have some time for Q&A as well. So let's welcome to Wexford and St. Alphonsus.
Better. And I spent the year going to Mass, reading scriptures and good books, devotional prayers, and you know, I felt better. I was about 20 at this point. And then one day my pastor pulls me aside. I was his altar boy for about 8 years. And he goes, "Tom, did you ever think of being a priest?" I go, "Monsignor, please. I just flunked out of college with a 1.8 GPA, physical education. I think I'm priestly material. You gotta reach the bottom of your barrel, the quota. I mean, really, come to me." And he goes, no, "Tom, please, there's a lot more to being a priest than all academics. You know, you have good qualities, you're prayerful. You know, there's a lot more to being a priest." And that really got me thinking. I thought, wow, maybe there is some hope for me here, you know. And so I didn't sign up that day, but it got me at least thinking. I traced my priesthood back to that point, gave me the nudge, gave me thinking about it. And I got a little bit more hopeful. He introduced me to what the prayers the priest cite. It's called the Divine Office. There are prayer books. Monks do it 7 times a day. Diocesan priests do it about 5 every 3 hours. And he got me praying, and he encouraged me to do daily Mass. He gave me books to read, and I could trace my priesthood to about this point. But I didn't think I was, ready to get to the seminary at this point. I decided to go back to college, the school in Massachusetts. I went there, but I was a little more focused now, and I got involved in campus ministry. I taught CCD at a local church. I was friendly with the campus chaplain. And I was hopeful at this time that, that my life has turned around, that I was headed in the right direction, and that God was with me. I even talked to a vocation director at that point. I got friendly with a Franciscan brother. He was taking classes at the college, and he said, "Let me talk to, Father so-and-so." And I talked to him, and he encouraged me. He didn't give me a pen to sign up, but I just felt a little encouraged. I felt more hopeful about my life at this point, that I'm at least going in the right direction. And I graduated from college, and on graduation I went to Rome with the college chaplain. I met John Paul II, and I actually got to shake his hand. And he blessed some rosaries that I still have. They're in my room in the rectory, and that was a very moving scene. It was in the outdoor, and if you've been to Rome, he gives an outdoor audience on Wednesdays. And I remember I was right up by this railing, and he come around, he was like shaking hands, and holding a baby, and I was getting crushed to death into this railing. And he shook my hand, and he blessed these rosary beads, and so it was a very, very moving experience. And after that, we went to Lourdes, and that was a very, any of you ever been there, it's a very, very moving place, and I had a great devotion to Our Lady of Lourdes and Bernadette after that day. And then after that, I went to graduate school, basically because I couldn't get a job in physical education. Kind of prolonged it here, but I felt better. I went to phys ed. I majored, got a master's in physical education down in Washington, D.C. at American University, and then I graduated. Then I graduated, and I taught for a few years, and then I worked in a fitness center in Manhattan. And a lot of guys there were training for an upcoming New York City Fire Department test. The test comes out every 4 years, and you got to be under 29 to take it. It's a very brutal physical test. Guys are training hard, and one guy I was friendly with said, "Tom, why don't you, take the fire department test?" And as Kevin told, I used to be in really good shape back then. I did marathons and triathlons, and he goes, "Oh, you should do well on the test. At least take the test." I have my phys ed degree, I'm proud of, I'm hopeful this is going to work out into something. But at least take the test as a backup. You don't know what's going to happen. So I took the test. 25,000 guys took the test. It was brutal. 2 guys died taking the test. And 1,500 passed it, and were on this list. And I was like 400-something on the list. So I eventually got hired. I got hired in February of 1985 on the fire department, and I wasn't sure what I was getting into. I was what they call first generation fireman in my house. I was the only one. My mom was horrified. You know, you're a fireman, dangerous. Oh my gosh, your dad is talking to me. And but all the guys that you have to go to a fire academy, everybody, their fathers, their uncles, their grandfathers, everybody. They got off the boat, they were on the fire department. I didn't know the difference between an engine, a truck, a halogen, a I didn't know anything. I don't even know where to put the water in the fire. I knew nothing. All I knew is they were red. That's all I knew. I don't know what I was getting into. And I had to go to this fire academy for 2 months. And it was pretty, you know, tough training and putting out mock fires and everything. And but anyway, I got through that. And then I got assigned to a firehouse in the North Bronx. And I was, you know, the fire academy, you go to the fire academy, there's a fireman here in the background. And, you know, you're putting out mock fires. It's during the day. And you know, it's very nice, there's instructors and safety nets around, everything is nice and lovely. But then you get to the firehouse, and my first, you never forget your first fire. You know, every firefighter will tell you that. And I was on the fire truck one night, it was about 2 o'clock in the morning, it was like March, it was dark, raining. And the new guy in the fire truck rides backwards. You know, I know the new fire truck, so I may all face forward, but the old ones, two guys go backwards, two face forward, and I'm riding, and I look to the guy across from me, his eyes became like silver dollars, and I turn over my head, the whole top floor of this building is on fire, and then we're going into there, we're going into that, and the guy's running off with our mask, and fell off, I'm running in, and couldn't see anything, I tripped on the floor, I had smoke everywhere. And I was like, my heart was going like this, the fire went out. Well, but never forget your first fire. But it was a wonderful year. I worked 9 years for this firehouse in the North Bronx. We had about 5,000-6,000 calls a year, so we were very, very busy. But a lot of fun, a lot of excitement. I still stay in touch with a lot of those guys. A lot of them came to my first ordination, and my first mass, and they, you know, they were those. Wonderful, wonderful years. Then after 9 years, I got promoted to lieutenant. That's the first officer rank. And I was assigned to a firehouse in Lower Manhattan, and that's where I was on 9/11. On 9/11, our shifts change at 9 in the morning. But if a guy comes in a little bit early, you can get relieved a little bit early. So I was the officer, so the next duty officer came in around 8:30 or so. So I got relieved and I was on my way home, and when I heard about the attacks on the tower, and they recalled all cops and firefighters to the scene. So I turned around, I went through the tunnel, they had the tunnels and the bridges all closed off at this point, but you showed your badges, we were allowed to get through. And we got to the firehouse, and the guys were just coming in from everywhere, and nobody was saying anything. We were all just stunned in horror. We just grabbed our fire gear and we started running down the West Side Highway that leads into Lower Manhattan. And we're just running down there to see firefighters just running in from all over. And the two towers were burning at this point. And just about when we got there, the first tower came down. And it was a huge roar. It was a horrific, horrific, horrific scene. And then everybody just started crawling on the pile looking for bodies. The reports were there were about 25,000 people in these towers. So we just started crawling on the rubble, and the air was very, very bad. There was asbestos everywhere. So it was full, but we weren't thinking about our health. We just plunged right onto the rubble trying to find any voids, anybody that we could find. Unfortunately, there were very few survivors. There were a couple of fire companies that were trapped in stairwells and voids, getting civilians out, and dug them out, and a few other people. But most people, unfortunately, were incinerated or were pulverized. But we didn't know that. We just had to keep digging and hoping that we'd find a life. We're digging, and then while we're digging, we were, while we were digging, it was on the South Tower, and we heard the whole drama of the day. The plane went down to Pennsylvania. You know, we didn't know what was going on. They hit the Pentagon. You know, we were like, we're like really, really frightened, but we had a mission to do, just keep looking for any life that we could find. The whole drama was unfolding. And I remember there was like no air, and I was just like breathing through my coat, most of the time. Everyone here, I could find, we all just covered, it's white and air, so trying to get it through my helmet. And it was very, very bad, the whole drama. And while we were there, and we were looking at the north, I thought, that was going to come down also. You know, but we just kept digging, and then also we just heard this huge roar. And we all just started running, scattering. And I remember ducking behind a car with two other guys. I don't know who they were, couldn't see them. We were just behind this car, and this plume of dust and ashes came piling over us. And thought I silenced that. Came over us, and we were there, and it felt like a couple of minutes. And then we're just like, you know, I mean, how old are we doing? And then we just see everybody go back on. Now we got two piles to dig through now. This time I moved over to the North Tower. I was over on the North Tower. And again, this thing, just hopefully we can find somebody, some survivors there that, but fortunately there weren't too many. And most of you probably know the story of Father Mike Judd. He was our chaplain. They listed him as the first guy killed. He was in the North Tower lobby. That was the North Tower was hit first. But the South Tower came down first, the second. Father Mike saw vintage photos. He was praying in the lobby. And a firefighter was killed. There were bodies that were coming out of the tower. A firefighter was killed by a random falling body. And Father Mike went out and was giving last rites to this firefighter. And at that point, the South Tower came down. And then debris shot across, killed everybody that was outside, including Father Mike. Then some firefighters, they dug Father Mike's body out, and they carried it. You might have saw that picture. He was in a chair to St. Peter's Church. It was two blocks north of the towers, and they brought Father Mike's body, and they laid it on the altar. Just a very fitting tribute to Father Mike. Yeah, he was a priest, you know, all the way to the end. Yeah, he died being a priest, giving last rites to somebody. And I'd be glad that he inspired me to be a priest. And I was thinking about it a little bit before that, but I just saw his great example and some other examples of good priests over the years, and that kind of inspired me. So I dug on this rubble. Well, that day I was working on the North Tower, and I was crawling all over the rubble, and I reached the top of the tower about midnight. And we were aiming for the stairwell. We figured if we were going to find any survivors, they were going to be at the stairwell. That's where they were going to trying to go, and we just, but unfortunately, we just found, unfortunately, very just compressed bodies. It was very, very gruesome. And we were there about midnight, then you got relieved there, then you worked your way down through the rubble. It took a long time to get up there, it took a long time to get back. But I remember about midnight, it was just a very surreal scene. I felt like I was on a movie set. I looked around, and the perimeter was cordoned off, and the army all around, military all around. There were just thousands of firefighters all over the rubble. You see the yellow reflective tape. And then they looked up the West Side Highway, and you just saw ambulance rigs all for miles. They all came down. Nurses, doctors, it just wasn't just firefighters who responded. A lot of police, EMS, they all responded. Also, all you just saw ambulance rigs for miles, and it was just, unfortunately, there were very few bodies put into those. It basically turned into a recovery operation. So I was on to the top about midnight, and there were jets flying overhead, and we just say, I hope they're ours, you know. And then I got relieved, and went back to the firehouse, and then just slept a few hours, and I called my mom. She was frantic, you know, worried about me all day, and because the cell towers were all knocked out, couldn't make any calls. So then I got a few hours sleep, then in the morning went back down to the towers and to the site. And I was there pretty much for the first 3 weeks. you know, and then, but also then too, we also still had fires to put out, you know, and you know, they calls, they still kept coming in, and we had no fire trucks. There was some like 90 fire trucks that were destroyed on 9/11. We had no fire truck for like 2 days. Guys were still at the firehouse, you guys digging down at the rubble, guys at the firehouse. Everybody came in, nobody took a day off, and guys were running down the street with the, in their cars, trying to put, you know, responding to these calls, and it was nuts. And for a couple, then we eventually got an old fire truck. They had like a fire truck graveyard, like these old fire trucks that were held together by duct tape. So we got one of these things, runs, and then so we used that for a few days, and eventually we got some new fire trucks. And then also was very nice and touching was a lot of fire trucks, as the firefighter years know, these trucks cost like about $500,000. You need to replace 90 of them. That's a lot of money. But there were communities that bought fire trucks. There was a firehouse near me, 14 engines. They were just two blocks over. A community from Oklahoma bought their fire truck. Just drove it in for them. They said, "Here's the keys. Here you go. On us." You know, so we had a lot of communities coming through, doing a lot of good things. But there, it was devastating. You had to get the rubble. You still had to respond to fires. Then on weekends, there were funerals. They started coming in, and they listed them. And it was very, very sad. And then you tried to pick out, I knew Joe, I knew Mike, and Pete. You tried to make as many as you can. So you went to funerals, you came back, you dug. You know, it was just brutal for about 3 weeks. So a lot of the widows, they wanted to have a funeral right away, get it over with. So they would have what they call memorial service. But if you find a body or a cart, then you can have a funeral. And that happened to three guys in my house, five guys in my firehouse were killed, and they had memorial services right away. But then a little bit before Thanksgiving, we found parts of three of the guys that were together. So they had funerals and kind of reopened wounds, and it was very, 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 very painful. And then, but it was just very heartbreaking because a lot of the widows, some widows gave birth after 9/11. You know, they named, and it happened in one of my firehouses, that they named their son after the father. It was just brutal. So went on to, so at the end of September, they realized no one survived this. So there's no sense having thousands of guys digging down here. So they just made it pretty much a recovery operation. So they took 1 month detail. So instead of going to your firehouse, they got a couple hundred guys to just go to ground zero and dig, and everybody else could go back to their firehouses. So I was there for 3 weeks. I kind of had enough and a lot of misery. So I went back to the firehouse. And then I went back there again at the end of May, which was the last month of recovery operations. And we were just finding bones, and it was very, very gruesome. And I was there for the final ceremony, which you might have saw, where they cut down the final beam and the big ceremony. And another nice story that Father Kevin mentioned, while we're digging, and you know, we're trying to keep this theme of being hopeful that we'll find people. And it was on, tomorrow would be October 4th, Feast of St. Francis. We had to work with the iron workers down at Ground Zero, because a lot of this, it was heavy concrete, steel beams, we couldn't move this stuff. You know, it wasn't like a normal building collapse with wood, you could move it. But you know, they would pull with their girders, they would move the rubble out, then we'd dig in through holes, try to find anybody parts. And what they did was they dug also this cross appeared. So you may have seen it, just stood up right in the middle of the rubble and on Feast of St. Francis, October 4th. And so they, iron workers cut it down, and then they mounted it on a concrete slab, and they had daily mass there every day at 9 o'clock. You know, the workers were digging, and then, you know, so not everybody would do it, but then they'd put their tools down, and they'd go have mass, and they'd have it. And then on Sundays, people from the area would come in, and you have a lot of people there. And if any of you get to see the museum, the World Trade Center Museum in Manhattan, it's underground. The two towers is reflecting pools. They have the names of 3,000 people killed. And underneath the pools is the museum. And they have that iron cross there. It's very, and then very, very touching. You come into the wall, they have a picture of the 3,000 people that were killed. And we also have some fire trucks that were destroyed. They have them on the on display. So I went back there for the last month, end of May. I'm going to find a recovery. Again, hopefully trying to find someone. It was a very, very brutal experience. 343 guys died that day. And since then, over 200 guys have died due to related cancers. Every guy that was there, the first 24 hours, they're tracking. And I have to go in December, get a medical. And it's, you know, federal government covering it. It's very, very good. They give you chest x-rays, lung tests, blood work. It's very, very good. And so far, everything is okay. But a lot of guys, they come in their 30s, 40s, come down with all these cancers. And 200 have died, and it's going to be growing. I think it's going to really be growing. And a lot of people ask, well, Tom, you know, you're a religious guy. Where was God on that day? You know, and he stopped that. Where was he? And I say, well, he was in the rescuers. That was the body of Christ. The firefighters, the police, EMS, doctors, nurses, that he was in the body of Christ. That's where it was. He was with us. Why would else would anybody show up or something like that? You know, God had to be within your heart. That was the body of Christ. He was with us on that time. We were just always hopeful, and even in the aftermath of this horror, you know, we've got to remain hopeful that some good can come out of it. And right after this, you can see it pulled the country together. The Manhattan firehouses turned into literally funeral homes. People were coming in all day, all night, from everywhere, getting condolences. We were kind of treated like celebrities. We got tickets for everything, you know. Yankees game, Met game, Rangers game, everything was dinner, everything. We didn't drink, we didn't pay for a beer for years. It was really, really great. What people did, old Broadway shows, hard and great. It was really great, but, you know, the people did, how they, you know, have wanted to share in on this horror, you know. And it was surge of national pride, you know, and a good, you know, appreciation of the first responders and the reality of good and evil. And also we have to be hopeful. A lot of people died suddenly that day, tragically, but give me hope of the resurrection. We have that promise of that hope of eternal life. That, you know, some things don't work out down here. People die quickly, suddenly, young, tragically. These guys all die. But there has to be hope. There has to be hope for the resurrection. And that's a very good promise that our Lord gave to us. And that helps us carry through this tragedy. So after all the kind of the dust has settled, in May of 2002, I got promoted to captain on the New York City Fire Department, and I kind of had a lot down there. I wanted to go back to the Bronx. You know, Manhattan was brutal down there, and a firehouse came open in Lower Manhattan, and nobody applied for it. They lost all their guys, got killed in 9/11. Nobody wanted to go there. So I was home one day, and I get a phone call. It's the battalion chief. The battalion chief calls you at home. It's kind of like the principal calling for your kid. You expect the worst, you know. He gives me a call. He goes, Tom, you got promoted to captain. And I see you want to go back to the Bronx. You know, yeah. Well, we need somebody for 21 truck. You know, no one's put in for it. Yeah, I know. Yeah, I'd like you to put in for it. I think you'd be very good for the house. You'd be the right guy. I could have told the chief, no, I got other plans. I want to go back to the Bronx, take it easy. I did enough, I suffered enough. Let me go. I'll think about it. I'll get back to you. I'll pray over it. I just said, yes, chief. I heard the voice of God speak to this battalion chief, and I said, yes, I'll go there. And so I took the assignment, and I did my final 3 years at this firehouse, another great, great, great firehouse. I had wonderful 3 years there, and so I took that firehouse. And also about this time, I had about 17 years on the fire department, and firefighters can retire in 20. So I was thinking, you know, what am I going to do for retirement? You know, thinking that the time I was always thinking about being a priest. You know, it was kind of always in the back of my mind. Even when I was a firefighter, I tried to go to daily mass, and I would pray, do my prayers in my office, and I thought about being a priest. So then, as I talked to the vocation director for the Archdiocese in New York, told him, I'm telling the firemen, I'm thinking of being a priest, and when I retire, he said, oh, great, love to have you. Never had a firefighter before. And so we started meeting, getting acquainted, and going on retreats, and so things were going very well. And also, I started visiting a monastery in upstate New York. You know, I was going up there every 6 months for about a week to discern the call to the priesthood. You know, hopefully this is what God was calling me. I was praying about it, and so I thought maybe this is the direction the Lord was leading me. And then things were going merrily along. Then in August of 2003, I was in a serious gas fire and explosion in Lower Manhattan. It was a big basement fire. I hit my head, and I developed a blood clot on the brain. And it required 2 brain surgeries, and I was in the hospital for a month. I even received last rites. As you can see, it worked. You know, but I always remained hopeful in my convalescence that I would recover, that the surgeon's hand would guide me through it, I'd be okay, and God still had a plan for me. I remained hopeful. So my surgeon said, Tom, you just had brain surgery. I think you better take it easy. So I did the logical thing. I entered a monastery, right? Monks don't do anything, right? You can sit around, do nothing, pray all day, pray the rosary, meditate. You know, plus the idea of studying for 6 years made my sore head hurt even more. So I entered a Benedictine monastery in upstate New York. If I thought I was going to get a rest, forget it. You know, forget it. You know, I first met up with the abbot. He's in charge of the monastery. He goes, oh, you were a fireman? Good. We need a cook. Get in the kitchen, start cooking. Our cook stinks here. You know, get in there, start cooking. I was cooking. And he goes, I heard you used to drive fire trucks. Good. We need somebody to plow in the snow up here. Upstate New York, it's probably snowing already. So you got to get up at 4 o'clock. You got to plow all the snow, the access roads, the parking lots. Okay, so I'm plowing all the snow. Then when it's nice, stop snowing, you got to mow all the grass. And I went out, I looked outside, I saw grass, I thought there's grass for miles. And there was so much grass to mow. I would start here. By the time I finished, I'd start over again. All I did was mow grass and plow snow and cook and plus do all the cleaning. And when I retired from the firehouse, I was the oldest guy. I was 48. You know, then I go up to the monastery, I'm the only guy in the 70s. So I had to like do everything. All the cleaning, I had to do everything. I was going to get fired. I had to cook with my sick brain surgery. And I go, oh, plus we get up at 4 o'clock every day, we pray every 3 hours, warm an hour of meditations, lectio, spiritual reading, and devotions. And there's no TV, internet, cell phones, no vacations, and there's no women. I wonder why there's so few guys there. People often ask me, Tom, what's life like in a monastery? You know, it's kind of a mystery on the other side of the walls. You know, what goes on over there? Well, it's kind of summed up in this joke that I kind of heard. It's not too far from the truth, you know. First day, guy meets with the abbot, and he tells him, okay, we wake up at 4 a.m., 7 times a day we pray, plus mass, and we're in bed by 8:30, there's no talking, total complete silence, and you're only allowed 2 words a year. That's it. I go, all right. So this guy's model monk for a year. A year passes, up at 4 a.m., praying 7 times a day, mowing lawns, plowing snow, and at the end of the 2 years, the abbot calls me and goes, what are your 2 words? food stinks. Too bad, this isn't a five-star luxury restaurant. Go back to your room and stop complaining. Go suffer for Christ. Another year passes. He's up at the end of the second year. He's up again a model monk. Up at 4 a.m., praying, plowing snow, mowing grass, saying nothing. And the abbot calls him in. Okay, what are your two words for the year? He goes, bed hard. He goes, too bad. This isn't the Holiday Inn. You gotta go suffer for Christ. Go back to your room and stop complaining. So another year passes, third year, again a model monk, up at 4 a.m., praying seven times a day, working all day, says nothing. The abbot calls him in and goes, what are your two words? He goes, I quit. He goes, good, you've done nothing but complain to the guy. Now get out of here. And this isn't too far from the truth. It's just about strange, but in a strange way, I enjoy the life. God gave me the grace to persevere, and I think the prayer life there, the simplicity, helped prepare me for the fire, for the priesthood. I did make my solemn profession on Pentecost Sunday of 2009. I took the name Thomas Bernadette. There's Bernadette in the crowd there, from Our Lady of Lourdes and Bernadette. Anyone be Brother Bernadette, they'd be breaking the chops, the guys. Thomas Bernadette. So I made my solemn confession. In the fall of 2009, the community sent me to St. Vincent Seminary, and that's where I met Father Kevin. As you know, the Trove, it's the home of the Steelers. I had to get used to root for the Steelers instead of the Giants and everything. But I enjoyed my time there. I had a wonderful 3 years, a lot of friends. But it was a little tough getting back. I was out of school 28 years. And a lot has changed since then. Now everything's on laptops. I'm like one of those dinosaurs. I write notes with a pencil. Everybody's like doing on laptops, everything's email and everything. And then when I came from the civil service, the guys here took civil service tests, it was multiple choice, A, B, C, or D, and when in doubt, you pick C. And now you go to the seminary, you write 15-page papers, and it's just total big adjustment there, and your first 2 years of philosophy. And if any of you have had philosophy, it makes no sense. It all sounds the same. And I took Greek and Latin, and I'm like, what am I getting into here? But I was always hopeful that, with God's graces, He would help me get through all this, which no matter how difficult the odds. And I was older than all the professors. My classmates would be my sons. Remember that movie, Back to School with Rodney James? That's from LA, but I had a lot of fun. But I go back to St. Vincent's, it's wonderful. I enjoy my time there, and I usually visit a couple times a year. I do blue masses for cops and firefighters. I've done that a couple times, and I do a retreat there. But I eventually, after a couple of years, I wanted to get back to the New York area. That was my original intention, to be a priest for the Archdiocese of New York, and to be near my friends, family, and the FDNY in active ministry. So in September 2012, I switched to the Archdiocese of New York and entered St. Joseph's Seminary. It's in Yonkers, just north of New York City. But I was always hopeful that this was God's original plan for my life. I continued to do well, as I had done at St. Vincent's. I had to get dispensed from my vows, which I did in spring of 2015, with all this paperwork going back and forth to Rome. And in the seminary, you get a summer parish assignment. My parish was in the Bronx, which was challenging. And during the year, 1 year I did prison ministry. That was interesting. And then the following year, I taught CCD to sixth graders at a Bronx church. And I'd say that the prisoners were better behaved. really, they were. At least they were behind bars. They were better behaved here. Really, they were great. And I got to meet when Pope Francis came to New York. My classmates, we were the altar boys for him at the Mass at Madison Square Garden. I carried the cross during the procession, and other guys carried the candles and the book. And what was real funny about that was, here we are at Madison Square Garden. There's going to be 25,000 people watching this, plus national television or whatever, and the Pope. And we really got to get this right. So at the seminary, we have a gym like this, and they set up like a mock altar, and the guy in charge of liturgy put it down to the inch, everything to the exact dimensions how it was going to be. at Madison Square Garden, it's at the altar up there. For like about 3 weeks, we practiced day and night, military precision. We wanted everything like perfect for the Pope, you know. So going through this. Then the mass was scheduled to start at 6 p.m. and they bust us down there at 10 o'clock. And we practiced from 10 o'clock to 4, going through it, everything, then at 4 o'clock, you know, the Pope shows up with his MC, that's the Master of Ceremony. He comes up, and he sees our act, and he doesn't like it. He goes, no. To make matters worse, he doesn't speak English. He only spoke Italian. And he's like, he didn't like our show at all. Fortunately, one of my classmates spoke a little Italian, so he kind of translated it. So here you are changing the game plan, you know, right before kickoff, you know. You go here, you gotta go over here. But fortunately, it all came out well. It was great. I got to shake Pope Francis's hand afterwards. He gave me blessed rosary beads, and it was very, 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 very wonderful. And then I ended up, I got ordained deacon, and I got ordained priest, and the guy that flunked out of college 40 years earlier, I graduated magna cum laude from the seminary with three masters. It shows you what God's grace can do. You remain hopeful, you trust in Him, the plan He has in your life. One of these degrees, I had to do a thesis paper, a 70-page thesis paper on the Transfiguration. That's a word I don't think I could have spelled 40 years earlier. Now I'm writing a 40-page paper on it. You know, but it was all amazing. And then God's grace, I've made hopeful, he had his plan, and it was very, very good. Then on May 28, 2016, I got ordained at St. Patrick Cathedral by Cardinal Dolan. I was the first retired New York City firefighter to become a priest. Two police officers had done it, but I was the first firefighter. I wasn't the oldest at 60. There was a guy a few years earlier got ordained at 62. He can have that record. Break his record. He can have that. You can have it. The cathedral was phenomenal. There were over 1,000 firefighters outside the cathedral with three fire trucks, banners, bagpipe bands. About another 400 guys got inside, plus 300 of my family, closest family and friends, plus those six nuns that I had in grammar school. That I tormented in grammar school. They were there. They were just wonderful. Shocked, you know. But it was really very, very wonderful. It was kind of a big to-do. Had 15 minutes of fame on Channel 2 and everything. It was a very, very wonderful day for my family, my friends, and the fire department. My first mass was at my home parish, and I actually even tried to have, because I had all these guys coming in and everything. I tried to have a reception someplace in Manhattan, you know, make it a little bit easier, but there. So I went into a place down there, the fire department, we usually have a holy name breakfast every year. So I will approach these guys. I tried to throw out all my discounts. You know, I'm a priest, fireman, captain, everything. $42,000. No break. You know. We might have rounded it off a dollar. I just gotta give them all my discounts. Didn't work. I said, fine, it's okay. I got up to my whole parish. We had a little wall. That's fine. Now, my first firehouse from the Bronx, they gave me a beautiful gold vestment. Embroidered it in the inside, said brothers forever. Beautiful. So I wear that on the big solemnities, Christmas, Easter, you know, big solemnities. Then my first Manhattan firehouse, they gave me a beautiful gold chalice on the Bible, so brothers forever, with my badge number engraved on it. Beautiful, I use that a lot. And then my last Manhattan firehouse, where I was a captain, they gave me, of course, a fire engine red vestment, you know. Also embroidered brothers forever on it, and I wear those vestments a lot. And I also have another red vestment for St. Florian, who's the patron saint of firefighters. I wear that one also, too. But after the ordination, the cardinal can sign you anywhere in the archdiocese, and everybody thinks you're going to get in Manhattan. You know, those are the plum parishes, and there's like 380 parishes in the archdiocese. three boroughs and seven upstate counties. And I got assigned to St. Mary's Mother of the Church in Fishkill, New York, about an hour north of New York City. It's a very wonderful place. I teach in the school, minister to all the people. It's very wonderful. There's a lot of the fire department still in me. Besides giving me a lot of homily material, these guys work in all my homilies. My first wedding was for a fireman's daughter. My first baptism was for a fireman's son. And I did the last three 9/11 masses for the fire department in Manhattan, which is done at St. Francis Church on West 31st Street. That was Father Mike's church. So the main mass is held there. Then I marched in the St. Patrick's Day parade like the last 7 years, but usually the fire department, and that was always a lot of fun. But also some sad moments. I did a concelebrated two line of duty deaths the last 2 years. Two firemen got killed, and usually a lot of guys show up for these, and I concelebrated the mass with Cardinal Dolan at St. Patrick's. So those are very, very, very brutal, touching things to do. I'm also a chaplain for a local volunteer firehouse near Dean, where I live. But it's an overwhelming, humbling feeling to be a priest of Jesus Christ. I did 20 years on the fire department, and I was always hopeful that the Lord would give me another 20 years as a priest. I'm truly blessed. The retirement plan here is great, you know, great boss, eternal benefits, you know. But it's I was always hopeful that God, you know, I started out rough. So any of you have children out there to flunk out of school with 1.8 GPAs, you say, well, we had this priest. He ended up becoming a priest with a 1.8 GPA. There's always hope, you know, the Lord has a plan for everyone in our lives. We just, he has good things in store for all of us. Yeah, just the overview of my life, I can just see that, you know, God working through my life and through the events. I was always helpful, always hopeful of his guidance, his love and concern that he has for all of us. We're his children. We just have to trust in his graces that he has a plan for us. You know, I dropped out of college and to get ordained with 3 degrees, just testament, as a testament of how God can work in our lives. We just always have to remain hopeful. And I was always hoping that I was on the right path, that he was with me. And this could just only be attested to the graces God gave me, God working in my life. Yes, I worked hard, but it was his grace that allowed all this to happen. The common thread of all this is that I walked with God and he was with me. I communicated with him in prayer. I heard his voice in the silence of my heart. I made the decisions and I followed his will to completion that he had for me. It wasn't always easy, but if one hears God's call to what plan he has for one's life, he gives you the graces to persevere to completion. They always say in the priesthood, God doesn't call the worthy, he makes worthy those whom he calls. We just all have to remain hopeful that he cares for us, he has a plan for us, and he will supply us with the needed graces to complete it. May God bless you all.
Too much. There's already enough here. All these thousands of guys in fire trucks and
cameras and that, because, well, look, they need a half-hour flight time from Brooklyn to get here or something. So they can work it back at the sign of peace. He texts these guys in Brooklyn and they go, so we're out under the cathedral, the car, and you see the street.
The other thing he didn't mention, the Bernadette, that's my mom. Yeah, some time for a Q&A. So if anyone has a question, I'll walk around with the mic and you can ask Father Tom maybe something that's on your mind or something you'd like him to cover. He's open to, he's a New Yorker, he'll talk all night. Well, while you're thinking about it, another thing he said, I said, hey Tom, you know, when he arrived here, there's another connection here with St. Alphonsus in New York. 20 minutes or so, first pitch for the Yankees in their wild card game. And a member of the Yankees is Neil Walker, right? Family parishioners here. He went to school here through sixth grade. And he was here just last school year to be with the kids. And I said, Neil Walker, Tom said, yeah, Neil Walker went here. You're going to get a lot of that after this is done. You're going to get a lot more.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
For Thomas here.
I get a little still choked up talking about it. It's just very emotional time. Still 17 years later, it's still very, very hurts.
Never forget.
Yeah, yeah.
While you're thinking about it, then, here's a good Thomas Colucci story in the seminary. So, you know, he didn't go into some Ironman triathlete, marathon runner. I mean, he showed photographs. He showed us what's a photograph when we got together of him doing a tri, and he's coming out of the water. And when you're done swimming, you come out of the water, you feel like Superman. You feel like Batman. I mean, you feel ripped. Right? He was ripped when he came out of the water. And we're like,
long ago.
Passing up all the women, man. So, you know, he's bicycled from Vancouver to San Diego. Who does that? Bicycle. That's a story in and of itself, and he would tell stories about that. So he would be one of the guys in seminary that would still jog. He would go out and run. There are a few of us, not too many of us that would go out and run. But Tom would get out and run, and I'd see him out running as well. And you can jog from the seminary into the town of Latrobe, if you're somewhat familiar with the area. And he told us the story one day, this afternoon. He went jogging into town, and if you're really familiar, some of you are somewhat familiar with Latrobe. There's a Domino's Pizza as you enter into town, into Latrobe. Well, he's jogging, I think he's jogging back. Right, or jogging into town, and on the sidewalk, a little unevenness. Okay, now think of the background here. Think of the background. When he's been Ironman triathlons, marathons, New York City fire captain, he's seen an awful lot of stuff. Right, been through and part of an awful lot of stuff. Well, he trips on the unevenness in the sidewalk and hits his head. And you know, if you hit your head, it bleeds. It bleeds a lot. Right outside of the Domino's. So you go in, so he walks in just to get a napkin, you know, just to get a napkin to put on it. And there's like a 16-year-old, like, pimple popper behind the counter. Yeah, and he's like, whoa, what's the matter? You're just bleeding pretty bad. You know? And Tom, and he's like, just give me a napkin, please, just give me a napkin. He's like, I gotta call 911. Here's the 16-year-old pimple popper on the phone with 911. There's an elderly man down. Elderly man down. We need an ambulance. They're asking him questions like, what's your phone number? He's like, I don't know my phone number. Definitely concussed. Nobody knows the phone number in the monastery. Where do you live? He said, the ambulance showed up. up. Nobody man down.
I put this band-aid on my head. It was about the size of my hand. I feel like I had brain surgery. I go back to the monastery. It was looking at me. And just a little cock.
But there was fun times there.
Any questions from anybody?
Left on your bucket list, if you have one. No, hopefully this is it. Well, you never know what the Lord has planned, but my mom always says, hopefully this is it. talking about my mom, I just want to be whatever the Lord asks me to do, whatever the cardinal asks me to do, I will go. I'm just very happy to be a parish priest in the parish, working with the people. We have a school, the kids are adorable, I've done a lot of weddings, and just working with the people is just a lot of fun. Whatever I'm asked to do, I'll go do. But nothing else really. Hopefully there's no more schooling, running out of years, how many years left, some of my classmates went over to Rome to study, fine, you can go through that, just to minister to people, be the best priest that I can. We're talking about my parents. Both of them are still alive. They're both 89, and they're terrific. I visit them on my day off, and they were tremendous for my ordination. Having an ordination, it's kind of like having a wedding. So they got to send out invitations, and then they got to set up the tables. Well, this couple doesn't like this couple. This couple doesn't like that couple. They set up the tables, and then getting down to the cathedral is a pain. So they had to get buses, and we had a lot of people come in from out of town, so we had to get hotel rooms, we had to get caterers for the hall and band. They did all that. Our dining room table was like the war room, all these sheets and papers. And I just had to worry about putting my vestments on the right way, And they were really a tremendous running it all. They were really a tremendous blessing, and they're still going strong at 89, so it's fantastic. But hopefully, now this is probably just, well, to be the best I can, be the priest I can, whatever I'm asked to do.
Just a quick one, and I'm sorry if you mentioned this already. Do you have any siblings, and were they always behind you on all these decisions? These are pretty monumental shifts.
My family was pretty supportive. I have two brothers, two sisters. My older brother, everybody thought he was going to be the priest. He's really smart. He actually teaches at Cornell. So we used to grow up. I heard a few kids do it at my parish. They practice saying mass. My older brother was the priest, and I'm the altar boy. And then the girl next door, that girl, a little progressive man, she was an altar server. But they were always, they knew I was always bouncing around, but they were always priests. And I was always fairly religious growing up. Most the godfathers and the government sponsors. So they knew that. It was always within me, the faith. It wasn't like I was leading a double life. I'm a priest, They knew it was always in the back of my mind, so they were very, very supportive in all my decisions. But getting on the fire department was a big shock, because we didn't have any history in the family. A lot of families do, their brothers, their uncles, and I was a fire department. You run to burning buildings, how's that fun? It's crazy, you guys are nuts, But that's how we got me on the job. The only guys that were happy were the firemen, You get out of college and we hang out at the local bar and how's your job? Oh, it stinks. How's your job? It stinks. And looking for something else and it's not what I want, And then the firemen, the only guys that were happy. They were always off, They loved going to work and can't wait to go to work. It's great. So that's when I, decided to take the test. But my family was always very supportive. I always had very religious growing up and that. I had their support. They were all at my ordination, and all my nieces and nephews, and they're all pretty good.
When Father Tom arrived this afternoon, and I came down and showed him this facility, the first thing he said, "Wow, my high school gym wasn't this nice. This is grade school." And then he looked at all the chairs set up. "How many people are coming tonight?" Thomas, you brought him out. Yes. Let's give it up one more time for the captain.
Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful evening. You brought us together in fellowship and peace. We thank you for the wonderful stories that we have heard. We ask that you always keep us always under your loving care. We ask this, Almighty God, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.